Good evening. It's good to see you all again here. I'm Michael Gerdes. I am an associate professor of music at San Diego State University, where I'm also the director of orchestras, and I will be your prelude lecturer this evening. I'm going to start differently tonight than I've ever started before. I'm going to start with a piece of music, an appetizer, if you will. We're going to listen to the entire piece, so don't be afraid. It's pretty short. Isn't it? Is there anybody ever heard that before? Anybody know what it is? It's Sibelius. It's a piece called Water Drops. And it's and although we can't quite agree on when it was written, there's pretty universal agreement that it's the first piece that Sibelius ever wrote. It's a piece written by a young Jana Sibelius before he changed his name to his musical name of John Sibelius, or Jean Sibelius, as we anglicize it. And that little 24-bar ditty reflects sort of the early promise of what will become Finland's most famous composer, who also happens to be one of my absolute favorite composers, so you're gonna have to hear a bit more about him, even though his piece on the program tonight is fairly short. But you can already hear, I guess, a few things, well, at least one thing that Sibelius would become known for, which is just this incredible melodic gifts, these tunes that he would come up with, something that he actually would move away from as a much more mature composer. And tonight's program offers a really special treat for any of you who are into Sibelius, who are interested in that composer, or for any of you who are just interested in hearing rarities or collecting rarities. If you're the kind of person who goes to a meal and orders something off of the menu because you've never seen it on a menu before, then you'll be really pleased. Because the piece that you're going to hear by Sibelius is a piece that I'm pretty sure none of us in this room have ever heard live before, and most of us have probably never heard at all. But first, if I can set the scene in Sibelius's life before you learn about the work. If you're familiar with Sibelius, you probably are familiar with him because of his strong identification with Finnish nationalism, the Finnish national anthem, Finland equals Sibelius. And whether that's through his opposition to Russian occupation, or the inspiration that he attributes to lonely walks in the woods, or the passing over ahead of a wedge of swans. I had to look that up. Wedge of swans. That's what you say when they're in flight. All of that actually comes later in Sibelius's life. In Finland, during the second half of the 19th century, you really get a sort of tale of two places, as it were. So from the 12th century up until the early 19th century, Finland is controlled by Sweden. But then since 1809, so since, you know, the early 19th century, in Sibelius' own lifetime, Finland is actually an autonomous territory that's under the control of Russia. But what this means is that in Finland there is a minority of Swedish-speaking Finns, who are sort of the cultural elite, and this is the group into which Sibelius is born. And then there is a majority of Finnish-speaking peoples who live really on the interior of the country. Sibelius's biographer, Dahlström, put it this way: the two sides of the Finnish character were substantially different. The one Scandinavian, and hence potentially more urbane, sophisticated, and international in outlook, the other Finno-urgic, rooted in the rugged peasantry, uncompromisingly idiosyncratic, inscrutable to the outside world. Sibelius actually grew up speaking Swedish. and did not learn Finnish until he attended his secondary school. Although he did write in some notes that he thought he could give lessons in Finnish after only about 2 years of studying it. The first passion in Sibelius's life was not his Finnish nationalism. That came later. The first was music. And so Sibelius begins studying violin at about the age of 15, which if any of you have studied violin or have children who have studied violin or grandchildren who have studied violin, you will know that 15 is not the desirable time to start violin. It's very late in life. So it was pretty incredible when only 5 years later, about 20 years old, Sibelius leaves his small town for the big city, 60,000 strong, of Helsinki. And he goes to Helsinki ostensibly to enroll in the university there as a law student, which was either a lie to his family or to himself, because it lasted for less than a year. And at the same time that he arrived and registered at the university for his law classes, he also enrolled in the newly founded Helsinki Music Institute as a violinist. But throughout his 4 years there, Sibelius found himself more and more attracted to the idea of writing music, of becoming a composer. He became the founder of the Institute of Music, Wigelius's protege, his star student and his star pupil. Now, Sibelius published nothing from these early school years, and one can actually tell that from the way the piece is listed in the program. So when you head into the concert or you take out your program look and you look at all the pieces, so like for example, the Chopin is opus 65 or the Beethoven, which is opus 59, number 2, you won't see an opus number on the Sibelius. Instead, you'll see something that says JS169, and that is just short for Jean Sibelius, 169, and it's not a publishing number, it's a cataloging number that was given by scholars later after his death as these works were discovered. So this is not a piece that Sibelius would have ever thought that we would be listening to in this concert, and it's certainly not a piece that most people have ever heard. These early pieces by Sibelius do have some commonalities. The Sibelius scholar Hepikoski said, Sibelius composed over a dozen conservatory-style chamber works and individual movements that were flavored with Nordic mannerisms and sentimental earnestness. I'm not quite sure what all of that means because it doesn't actually have folk songs in it at this point, so I don't know. So, I think what that is meant to allude to is the idea that they have really catchy melodies. And so this is sort of the hint of the gifts that will come even later as Sibelius becomes a much more serious composer. Very few recordings of this work exist. In fact, I found one. And it was impossible to get a hold of the music. So I did a lot of listening to try and talk about what's actually going on in this piece to help you prepare for it. And so during that time, the thing that I noticed most about it is how tuneful it is. In fact, it's been stuck in my head for a very good long time. And so I'm going to do that to you. The form is relatively simple for this piece of music, and I'll start out by saying I always end up talking about form in lectures, and I hope that it's helpful in the way that you listen. It's usually unnecessary in something that's 45 seconds long, like that first piece, Water Drops, that we listened to, as we just don't have enough time to get bored, or to forget what we've heard, or to lose track of what we were listening for. But this piece is a little bit longer, and it's a little over 7 minutes long, and so there's a lot to listen to in it, and there's no language. So what do we listen for in form? This is going to be a type of binary form, and almost everything that you hear tonight, with the exception of a really important movement in the Klein, is going to be some sort of binary form. And binary just means two parts, and it's usually going to be the first part that you hear, you'll hear again at the end. And that is true for the Sibelius. So if we think of the overall form of this piece, it's A, B, A. And then the A section itself is actually smaller versions of that form. So the first A section is actually a little ABA. Then there's the big middle section, and then a little ABA again. So if you're keeping track, that very first theme that you hear right after this short little introduction, you actually hear four times in the piece. You hear it right at the beginning, then you take a brief departure and you hear it again. Then there's this middle section that sounds completely different. And then at the end, you hear it repeated. And this is what that A theme sounds like. And this is what has been stuck in my head nonstop. Sometimes when you hear it, the cello will be playing pizzicato underneath it, plucking. Sometimes it'll be arco. Sometimes you'll hear it with a harmony provided by the second violin, but it will always be this tune. You'll hear it four times. It's already stuck in there, isn't it? It's waltzy. Four times. You'll love it. Every single one of them. Has anybody heard it on recording before? It's a lot of work. Probably half of you will go looking for it after you hear it tonight. But I'm so excited to get the chance to hear this young student work that, I mean, if you wanted to play it, you'd need to brush up on your Finnish and send a letter to the Sibelius Academy to see if you could get your hands on the music. So what a treat. Of course, Sibelius, as this young man, this 20-some-odd-year-old student, is seemingly far less serious than the one that you encounter in, like, his Fourth Symphony, you know, his austere works. And he's less grandiose than the one that you encounter in the Fifth Symphony, but he still loves playful endings. And so at the very end of the piece, in a sort of nod to music history, he actually deploys a Picardy third, which is just this simple switch from the minor mode that sounds sad. By moving the third up a half step, he changes it to the major mode and gives it a happy sound on the very last note. And it's a little silly. The appropriate reaction is probably not a laugh out loud, but at least a little smile as the piece ends. And it sounds like this. Whole thing's been minor, but he just thought, oh well, it'll be cute. The next piece is much more serious that you hear on the program, and I imagine it's one that many of you have heard before and are excited to hear, and it's the Chopin Sonata in G minor for piano and cello. It's composed near the end of Chopin's life. In fact, it's his last major composition of his life. And it's important to note that actually the composition date in your notes is a little off. It's when he started writing it. But one of the things to note is that Chopin was really fast. When he wrote music, he was more like Mozart than Beethoven. Not a lot of sketches, not tons of rewriting material, recycling it, not laboring over it. He was much more like, comes out of his mind, he walks over to the piano, he's able to play it, sounds great, awesome, let's go. In fact, all of his compositions involve the piano in some way. And this is probably his biggest work outside of the concertos for, you know, as a chamber work that involves equal sound from another instrument, from the cello. But he had a really rough time composing it. It didn't come out in a month, didn't come out in a year. It was just a horrible time in his life. And so one of the reasons for that is that Chopin suffered from tuberculosis. It had flared up earlier in his life, and he had managed to live through it, but it was always ever present, and it was what would eventually kill him. And sketches show that while he's writing this piece, he just discarded an incredible amount of material and redrafted it. He'd start it over again. He couldn't decide what form he wanted to have for the work. He wrote to his sister, it's a really famous quote, he says, "I write a little and I cross out a lot." In December of 1845, he wrote to his family that he was trying to finish it. But more than 10 months later, in October of 1846, he was still working on it. So this may have been from 1845 until 1847, years that he was working on this sonata. And what he said then is, "Sometimes I'm satisfied with my sonata with cello, and other times I'm not. I throw it into a corner, only to gather it up again later." And perhaps the darkest cloud over his life at this time was the end of his long relationship with a woman named Amantine Lucille Aurora, who is better known by her pen name, George Sand. And their relationship had ended over Chopin's refusal to cut off communication with her daughter, Solange, who she had married a man that really Chopin didn't approve of either. But this individual had asked for money from the family, and when he found out he wasn't going to get a bunch of money from this novelist, he became violent at one point until they were both sort of exiled, kicked out of the house, basically kicked out of the family. But Chopin was unwilling to let this person go from his life and still continue to have communication with them and said, you know, that they're family. And so the relationship ended. And to add insult to injury, she even parodied Chopin in her next novel. And it was pretty thinly veiled parody of a Eastern European artist who was whiny and spiteful. And this, I'm sure, incredibly hurt Chopin. And so perhaps this is one of the reasons why this piece took him so long to finish. And there is a bit more than just stories about his ex-girlfriend that lead us to believe that. And so the part that goes beyond stories is that Chopin's performance of this work did not include the first movement, which is really strange. The performance that he gave as a premiere was only the second, third, and fourth movement. The first movement is as long as all of the rest of them added up together. So to leave the first movement out is a really strange thing to do in the first place. And so why might that be? And so before talking about the form of the movement, just to talk about the actual melody that you hear, this is how the first movement of the cello sonata opens. And what you're going to hear is you're going to hear a piano playing solo as part of an introduction. Then there's a little bit of fancy Chopin filigree that lasts very shortly. And then the cello actually introduces the theme proper. It'll sound similar to what the piano plays, but not exactly the same. You can tell that what the cello is playing comes from the piano. And it is just the first theme. It's really beautiful, it steps down, and that's what you want to really listen to, is the sound of the cello after the piano plays the introduction. This is the opening theme of Schubert's Winterreise. It's a song cycle. So it's like a winter trip. And I just, without saying any more about it or its subject matter, I just want you to listen to the entrance of the solo singer in this piece. So this is not Chopin, this is Schubert, Winterreise. Now, not too much time has passed between the two that you can hear that they're related. This is really almost a direct quotation of the Schubert song. And this is not a little known song. This is one of the most important song cycles in all of music history. And to quote it, to quote this opening song, Gute Nacht, which is really, the opening lyrics are about, as a stranger I came in and as a stranger I go out. And the overarching theme of the Winterreise is a lover who is saying goodbye, not necessarily in the happiest of circumstances, to their former and once great love affair. And so to leave that out, either because of fear that people would recognize it and think that it was a strange move, or because it was too emotionally powerful, but to just leave it out of the premiere performance is so incredibly strange. In fact, this movement is incredibly strange. And so it is the last thing that Chopin ever heard before he died, so on his deathbed, he asked for music, and his friends, the cellist who he premiered this with and a student of his, played some Mozart for him. He said, no, can I hear my cello sonata? And then he stopped them after the opening theme. And it was the last music that he heard before he passed away, which certainly adds a lot to the idea that this particular movement meant something to him, and was perhaps a little bit disturbing or a little bit unbearable for him as a person when he would listen to it, at least what it would conjure up. And so this actually is evidenced in the form in some ways as well. So you'll remember that for the Sibelius, I said that binary form was really important. And in the Chopin sonata, it's a sort of version of binary form that we call sonata form. And you'll be familiar with it if you've heard anything called a symphony or anything called a string quartet or anything called a sonata. Usually the first movement is sonata form. And all that means is that instead of that sort of A-B-A thing, is that that A section, just like in the Sibelius, we hear two themes, that little A-B bit right there. And in the middle, instead of getting something new, the composer develops those themes. They play around with them. Then they could just vary them, new harmonies. They could take out little bits and pieces of them in the way that Beethoven does so well and so often, and just take all of these little small sections. Maybe they'll treat them contrapuntally. It'll sound like older music, like Bach or anything. But the idea is that we go on a journey with this music, and then we come back to it. And so we know that we're almost there in the piece. We're nearing the end of it when it sounds like the beginning again. But of course, what does Chopin do? Because it seems like the beginning of this piece of music is a big problem for him. So he doesn't bring it back. He doesn't recapitulate it. So you're going to hear that first tune, and then you're going to hear the second theme. And the second theme is really easy to catch because it almost sounds like a bell tone. You hear this like one, two, and three. This long, short, short, long of the exact same chord being repeated first by the piano and then by the cello. And that's our second theme. It sounds like this in the exposition, in the first part of sonata form. So that's the beginning of the second theme. And so once we heard that, we've heard that first theme that falls, that one that sounds like Winterreise, and then we hear this bell chiming theme, and then we get a development, and everything's getting exciting, and he's moving us through different keys. In fact, somebody said too many keys. There's a quote out there that says that this sonata is like wandering through a forest and seeing like nothing but disaster, and then occasionally a little flower that's still alive. But we're all over the place, and when it finally feels like we're headed back to the beginning and we're going to hear that beautiful melody again, instead of hearing that opening melody, we hear those bell tones. We hear the second one, and he just skips right over it, and we don't get it. Recap with the second theme instead of the first. The second movement is a scherzo, and so a scherzo is just the same exact form as that Sibelius. Something, something different, and then the first something that you had again. And it's going to be really easy to track because you'll know as soon as you've hit that middle something, because it sounds like a totally different piece of music. The scherzo is super fast. It's really exciting. If you're a fan of Chopin, it often gets compared to like the sound of a mazurka, like a dance, like a Polish dance. But the middle section, he just lets the cello wail. Like the cello just gets to sing this beautiful line over it. And every time I've ever heard the piece, that middle section is slower. So it's really easy. You're just like, oh, did they just start a whole new piece that's slower? I must be in the middle section. And then when you hear what sounds like the beginning, you're in the last third of the piece. The slow movement is beautiful and incredibly simple. It's also incredibly short when it's written out, but long when you hear it. So it is truly a slow movement. Like if you look at the page, there's just not that many measures, but they're playing incredibly slowly. And it's beautiful. It really defies explanation because the material is fairly simple and just beautiful, so let it wash over you. The final movement is a proper sonata form. And so I won't talk about it that much other than to say that when you listen to the final movement of the Chopin, it will be a chance to hear a recapitulation like most audiences would expect it, to hear the first theme come back in a way that it was played at the very beginning. And I don't want to run out of time for the rest of the program, so I'm going to move on from the Chopin to the Gideon Klein. The Gideon Klein piece is called a string trio, and I want to disambiguate the word trio for a second because somebody asked me after a lecture, because I used trio a bunch in the lecture in different ways and didn't talk about it. So trio can mean a couple things. It could mean that there are literally three people playing the piece, which is why the Gideon Klein piece is called a string trio. It can also have to do with, there are things called trio sonatas, a very old Baroque form of music that's about texture. There are two high voices and then a bass part that provides the harmony. And that word for a trio is where we get the scherzo form that I just described of the Chopin. And it's just what we call the little middle part, and it's because it was traditionally in that texture. Doesn't mean that there's going to be 3 minutes of it or that three people are playing it. It's just an old-fashioned name for that middle section that really doesn't make any sense unless you know the history of it. For the Gideon Klein piece, it's called a string trio not because of the form, but just because there's three people playing it. It's a trio. There's not a lot to say about Gideon Klein in terms of his biography because he died so young. At the same time, I guess there's an awful lot to say about why Gideon Klein died so young. So he was a very promising student in Prague, promising enough that after he had finished up his initial studies in that great city of Europe, he was offered a scholarship to study at the Royal Academy of Music in London. A very promising composer indeed. He was barred from traveling to London and from continuing any schooling in Prague because of the takeover of the Nazi Party in Czechoslovakia. He was able to live in Prague and sort of work in avant-garde circles for a couple of years before he was sent to the ghetto at Theresienstadt. And Theresien was seen as the model concentration camp. It was one of the few concentration camps where artists were allowed to do their work, to be artists, to compose, to play. There were concerts. Of course, this was all for propaganda reasons. And this has to do very much with this work. This work is Klein's last work, and also probably the last work composed at Theresien. This string trio was written near the beginning of September, and or about the middle of September and the first week of October, very quickly. And then about a week after he finished the work, he was loaded onto a transport and sent to Auschwitz. And then because he was one of the youngest members of the camp, he was actually moved on and not murdered at Auschwitz, but was sent to another concentration camp, Fürstengrube, which was a coal mining camp, where he died in January of 1945, about 3 months before the camp was liberated. And just so I don't mince words about it, he did not die because he was working in coal mines. He was most likely murdered when the camp was liquidated as the Nazi forces were losing. So this is what is left of his legacy at 26 years old. It was written at a very strange time in the camp's history. So this was written between when there was a famous Red Cross visit to examine the camp, and there was a propaganda documentary that is still available online that you can watch and see the propaganda that Hitler put out about his great concentration camps where art was made. As soon as this film was finished in sort of that summer of 1944, the orders started coming in for trains to be moved in and for residents of the camp to be moved on to Auschwitz. And so it is quite possible that Klein knew he was writing his last piece while he was writing it. And so for that, musically, this piece is a bit of a surprise. It's all sorts of quotations, and it's often heard as being surprisingly cheerful. And a little bit of that I'm going to try to ruin for you right now. It's three movements. The first and third are quite short. They're full of quotations and they're experimental, but they start to play with the use and quotation of folk songs, which was weird for Klein. His earlier music was atonal, was very experimental. He wrote music that had quarter tones in it. And so these pieces are actually, they're not going to sound like the Beethoven, but they're really quite conservative for him. And the second movement is the longest. It's longer than all of the rest of them. And it opens with this theme. Which is a folk song. And this is how this Moravian folk song actually sounds with its lyrics. And it's about this tall tower in the center of town that they sing about the birds flying through it, geese, and then they say that there are many geese, and then the geese are shot. And so it is a rather dark sounding folk song. But the shape of the movement is actually really easy to understand, and it's quite lovely. You hear that tune, and it sounds dark and sort of the mood of the folk song right when it opens. But then we get this very pleasant set of variations. That there's just all sorts of different versions of it, played with different styles, played with different harmonies, and it's actually quite a bit of fun to track. Each one of them has a big space between them, so you'll be able to count them and go like, oh, I wonder what will happen in this one. But in the very center, which is strange in art music, that the center of a piece would be more important than like the first thing that's introduced or the way that the piece ends, but in the very center is the only variation that is slow. And at the very end of that variation, after we hear the folk song presented in probably its sort of most pure form in the piece, there's just a slight little interruption from the cello. It sounds like this. That's it, just that little moment. But that little extra bit that the cello plays is certainly there on purpose. It's not a part of the folk song. And I don't know what it is. But there are ideas of what it might be. Scholar Michael Beckerman has written about the piece and specifically about that moment. He says, in the end, none of us can say precisely what the cello interruption in Klein's trio means. I have ideas. Maybe the setting of one of the lines from Verdi's Requiem, which Klein accompanied for dozens of rehearsals and performances in Theresienstadt. Perhaps the Liberame with descent to eternal death, that it represents a nod towards the Jewish mourner's Kaddish. In other words, that it's a prayer for the dead. That it is a passage that forces the cellist to physically act out the fear and trembling of the times, or even that it is simply the ultimate inchoate musical scream of someone being choked and strangled at the very edge of the abyss, as some have called Terezin. I know that's not the happiest part of the lecture, but it's a really incredible piece of music to know the circumstances of its composition. And that is the moment in the music that I would encourage you to listen for and then wrestle with. The concert then ends with Beethoven. And the Beethoven is incredible. It's one of three quartets that he wrote for a commission for a great Russian prince. And they're called the Razumovsky quartets. And this middle one is often seen as sort of problematic. The time in Beethoven's life when this happens is right after he sort of found out he was going deaf. And that's the whole story about Beethoven. He went to Heiligenstadt and he wrote his version of to be or not to be, that is the question that we call the Heiligenstadt Testament. And he decided that he was going to be reborn as the greatest composer ever. This is his heroic period. He writes his third symphony. He's working on, he's gone through a great time right now as a composer. He's working on his opera, which he really wanted to call Leonore, that we all know as Fidelio. And at the same time, he gets this commission. And one of the biggest things to listen for in this piece, because I'm running out of time, so we'll have to do the short version, is that Beethoven is wrestling with what to do with all the ideas that he has in a form that usually didn't contain so many. And so when we get to the first movement of this quartet, it has a repeats problem. Beethoven, it's in sonata form, and so it has an exposition, a development, and a recapitulation. Now, in the time of Mozart and Haydn, it was not uncommon to repeat both of those sections, the entire exposition, just so you could really get it, and then the entire development and recapitulation. Also, it was nice because it doubled the length of the piece, so then you didn't have to write any more music, and you still pick up your check, and off you go. But the problem is, and this occurs starting with the Eroica Symphony, Beethoven writes these repeats, and musicians aren't quite sure what to do with them, because these movements are massive. So one of the things to listen for tonight is that after you hear the first two themes, it's probably really likely that you'll hear them again, that you'll hear the exposition again, but I have never heard a performance of this piece where the actual development and recapitulation are both repeated. But if you do, if you notice, strap in. The second movement of the Beethoven is a slow movement. And the thing that's strangest about it, but that will actually be helpful in terms of flexing your muscles for listening to sonata form, is it is one of the only, maybe the only slow movement I can think of in a Beethoven work that's cast in sonata form. It's longer than the first movement because of this. So it's all of the things in sonata form, those first two themes, plus whipping them around in a crazy Beethoven way and then bringing them back, but it's also slow and pretty. So what that means is that it clocks in at like 11 minutes, where the first movement is only 9. And the third movement is where I think things get really interesting. It's probably the tune, if you don't walk out humming the Sibelius, you'll walk out humming this. Maybe you already know it. So this is the scherzo. And it's the really fast version of the movement that's just something different and then something back. And the something different is one of the most famous movements. In the Razumovsky quartets, Beethoven was asked to include a Russian tune. And so this is how he did it. Now, before I play you the little sample and you get to hear it tonight, I want to give you like the sort of general pitch about this folk song. Beethoven sets it in a way that it's almost unrecognizable as a folk song, because it's the one place in the quartet where he goes nuts writing imitative counterpoint. Everybody is coming in with the same tune at different times, over the top of one another. It's incredibly complicated, and it's also breakneck fast. Some people have taken that as maybe Beethoven was annoyed that he got asked to put a specific tune in it. I just think it's Beethoven showing off that he's Beethoven. It's a really cool spot. It sounds like this. And it'll be more fun when you have to watch human beings try to make those sounds. The last movement is, I think, the most fun. It's the one that I have the most fun listening to. And the reason why is because I feel like I can hear Beethoven trying to figure out his repeats problem. He's trying to figure out, how do I take all these ideas I have that I want to develop and how do I make them work in this form? So the last movement is traditionally called a sonata form. But it's a little odd for that. And when you read your program notes, you're going to read that it starts in the wrong key. It starts in C major. So it starts sounding happy. And And eventually it finds its way to E minor for its second theme, which sounds sad, like the way it starts. And you can just think of those. This is actually a great happy accident because it means that you can track those two themes really easy. So the first theme is the happy sounding one, and the second theme is the more maudlin sounding one in the minor key. And then you'll hear this really strange and kind of short development section. And then you get them both back. And now this is supposed to end, right? But Beethoven can't stop. So he plays the first theme and he develops it. And then he plays the second theme and then he develops it. And then he goes through another development section. And then he brings the first theme back again. And by now, if you're keeping track in the audience and you hear that first theme, you're like, oh my God, how many more times is he going to do this? Because I do have other things to do with my life, Mr. Beethoven, thank you very much. And it's right there that he does something that he's really accustomed to doing that he almost perfects in the Scherzo of the Ninth Symphony, where he just pulls a fast one and he starts that A theme all over again, and then he puts on the turbojets, and all of a sudden we have this Piamoso where it just rushes to the end, and it ends almost immediately in this huge, exciting flourish. And it's really Beethoven figuring out, how do I write in this form? It's a super happy ending, especially after the Klein. I hope you enjoy it. Thank you so much for spending your time with me before the concert.